In this video, we're going to talk about how many exposures we need for exposure blending. When I shoot, I usually auto bracket my exposures. So I have my exposures set at one stop apart, and I let the camera shoot between 5 and 9 exposures for me. So you can see all of these images were shot one stop apart. My goal here is to get my darkest exposure to have all of the information in the highlights, so there are no overly exposed areas unless it's shooting into the sun like this one. And there are no underexposed areas in my brightest exposure. So when you're shooting a scene, quickly look in your live view in your camera, go to the darkest exposure, make sure all the highlights are covered so we have no overexposed areas, and make sure in your brightest exposure, all of the shadows are covered too, so you have no clipped underexposed areas. Now, when it comes to actually exposure blending, I almost never use more than 3 exposures. Exposure blending is different to HDR. In HDR, we can use more exposures like 5, 7, 9 in order to get a better final result. The problem with HDR software is it doesn't have full access to our RAW files, and RAW files in general have a huge amount of information. But with exposure blending, we do have access to those RAW files, so we don't need all of those exposures. Most of the time I use 2 or 3 exposures and that's it. So there's a very particular way to choose your exposures for exposure blending. The first thing I do is decide which of my exposures is the base exposure. This exposure is my best exposure. So if I only had one exposure to work with, this would be the one I would choose. So I'm going for my 0 exposure here. Now for my dark exposure, I would go for one which contains the information and the highlights that we need, but that isn't too dark. For example, our darkest exposure here is far too dark. Blending this and the base exposure together simply wouldn't look natural. Our second darkest exposure has more information, but it's still extremely dark. So I would probably go for this exposure here. So it isn't too different from the base exposure in terms of brightness, but it has more information in the sky here. And if we want to bring back any of those highlights, we can just bring back the highlight slider a little bit. So when we blend these two exposures together, we're going to have a much more natural blend. And I'm going to show you exactly what I mean once I finish demonstrating this. And for my brighter exposure, I want one which is just a little bit brighter than the base exposure, which has no underexposed areas. So this one would probably work fine. We have some dark areas, but nothing too underexposed. As you can see from our histogram, we have a tiny clipped area here, which is probably around this area. But if I wanted to, I could probably use this extra bright exposure too. But with this image, I would certainly go for this exposure, and our base exposure here. So let me show you what this means in a practical example. So I'm going to close this, and we're going to look at an image from WhitePocket. So we have 3 exposures. Here we have a base exposure. So this has all the information in the foreground. We have no underexposed areas, but the scene isn't particularly contrasting. So we could probably just work with one exposure in this example. But nevertheless, I want to show you what I mean by choosing the correct exposures. So let's say this is our base exposure here, and we want to blend in a darker exposure. So we can choose our darkest exposure, or I have another dark exposure here, which exposes nicely for the sky. But the foreground is a little bit dark. Now let's say I go for my darkest exposure. So I choose my darkest exposure, and I'm not actually going to exposure blend here. I'm just going to choose rudimentary selection. Just select the sky here. Now I can make sure my darkest exposure is selected. And if I create a mask, we've now blended those 2 exposures. But you can see that they don't look natural at all. And that's because the darker exposure is too many stops away from the base exposure. They're too different. It's like putting a nighttime shot on top of a daytime shot. It just wouldn't work. We need the darker exposure to be brighter. To show you how this works in real terms, I'm going to create a curves layer. I'm going to clip it just to the darker exposure so it only affects the darker exposure. Now watch how it looks more natural now. So I'm brightening up the darker exposure. And now look at the blend. It looks much more natural. And that's just because we've brightened up the darker exposure. But I'm going to make these invisible now, and I'm going to select this mask. I'm going to hold down Control on a PC or Command on a Mac, and we can recreate that selection. Then I select this other dark exposure, I create the mask on it and you see we have the same mask as before. Now, look at how natural that blend is compared to the darker exposure from before. If I make that darker exposure visible, that's the first blend and that's the second blend. So it looks more natural because we used a darker exposure which wasn't too dark. So essentially I would blend this scene just with two exposures, the base exposure on the bottom here and then this darker exposure. Another image that I would use just two exposures on is this one here. See, we have a dark exposure on top, which is extremely dark in the foreground, but we have a good sky there. And the exposure underneath is a brighter exposure, but we have an overexposed sky. Now, after exposure blending, with just two exposures, we now come out with a much more balanced scene. So we didn't need 5, 6, 7 exposures to do that like we would in HDR. We can just use two exposures to come up with a really clean and balanced result. In terms of three exposures, here we have an interior shot and we have on top a really bright exposure. So I'm gonna bring that opacity up to 100%. Now you see that that exposure is really bright and probably too bright to blend into this scene. And then we have the darker exposure here. I'm gonna disable this mask and that's naturally a dark image, but we have brought back information in these windows and in the windows to the right and to the left. And also we've got some information from these lights hanging from the ceiling. And under that we have our base exposure. So remember, our base exposure is our best exposure. It's usually our zero exposure and it's the image that has the most amount of information in it. So you'll notice our dark exposure isn't really dark. We can still make out most of the information in this room. We can see the details in the ceiling, we can see the details in the wall. It's not super underexposed. So that means when it comes to blending, if I just make this mask visible, we create a really natural blend. Now with the brighter exposure, that is incredibly bright and too bright for this scene. But the great thing about bright exposures is once we've blended them, like we did here, we can bring down the opacity of a brighter exposure significantly. And now we have a natural blend. We can actually bring down the brightness of a darker exposure to get a similar effect, but it often isn't the best way to do that. So for example, if I go back to this image and I make my darker exposure visible, see, if we bring down the opacity to around 31%, we still get quite a nice result. Now the problem with doing that with the darker exposure is sometimes when we shoot, in our base exposure, we might have some beautiful clouds which are a little bit overexposed. But in our darker exposure, if those clouds are moving quickly, they'll be in a different place. So if we bring down the opacity of the darker exposure, we'll bring through some of the clouds on that base exposure as well, and it'll look kind of strange and duplicated. So that's why it's not always best to bring down the opacity of the darker exposure. But if you don't have any movement in the clouds, then that's a good solution to making your blend more natural. So just to recap, when we're shooting our exposures, we have to make sure our darkest exposure is covering all of the highlights so we have no overexposed areas. We've got a good base exposure with plenty of information in it. And we've got a brighter exposure that covers all the shadows. And when it comes to exposure blending, we only need 2 to 3 exposures. And we shouldn't choose a really dark exposure to blend with our base exposure because it won't look very natural.